Good morning. Once again, we invite all guests to take their reserved seats. Please go ahead and take your seats. Ladies and gentlemen, we'll be beginning momentarily. Ladies and gentlemen, we will begin our ceremony in just over 5 minutes now. In order to preserve the dignity of this solemn ceremony, please silence all electrical devices, including those with hourly chimes. Guests in uniform, this will be a covered ceremony. Today's streaming online broadcast is provided by the National Park Service. And due to operational commitments, we will not raise Cleary Bridge this morning and will forego a ship pass and review. However, we will observe our traditional moment of silence at 7:55. Again, we'll begin in just a few minutes. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to today's Joint National Park Service United States Navy National Pearl Harbor Remembrance Day Ceremony. I am Jason Blunt, Chief of Interpretation for the World War II Valor in the Pacific National Monument, and I am truly honored to serve as today's Master of Ceremonies on this historic 76th anniversary. This year's theme is Rising to the Challenge. Today, we pay tribute to those members of the greatest generation who rose to the challenge, beginning here in Pearl Harbor and on Oahu, in order to achieve a more peaceful world. Will guests please rise as able for the arrival of the official party? The official party for today's ceremony includes Mr. Stephen Toomey. Ms. Jacqueline Ashwell, Superintendent, World War II Valor in the Pacific National Monument, National Park Service. Pacific Fleet arriving. Side boys, post. Guests, please be seated. Ladies and gentlemen, it is customary on December 7th that we observe a moment of silence at 7:55 to commemorate the beginning of the attacks on Oahu. At 7:55, you will hear the sound of the USS Arizona ship bell rung by Park Ranger Chris Chang to mark the start of our moment of silence. Completing the moment of silence will be F-22 Raptors from the 199th and 19th Fighter Squadrons, known as the Hawaiian Raptors, executing a missing man formation just beyond the USS Arizona Memorial and over Ford Island in honor of those who lost their lives in defense of their country 76 years ago today. Please remain seated as the flyover takes place. The missing man formation was first used by the United States military in 1938. While aircraft have evolved and modernized since then, the concept of paying tribute to a fallen with this aerial salute is still used at funerals and memorials today. You may see one aircraft pull away from the formation and fly high into the clouds to honor the lives of those lost on December 7th. This tactic of a single aircraft pulling away from the group was not part of the original missing man formation, but has come to become a routine element since the end of World War II. It represents a lost comrade departing while humanity and the mission at hand continue on. The empty space left in the formation by the skyward aircraft symbolizes the loss of fallen comrades and demonstrates to all that we shall never forget their sacrifice. Ladies and gentlemen, at this time, please bow your heads as we observe a moment of silence to honor events that began at this moment 76 years ago today.
Thank you.
We thank the 199th and 19th Fighter Squadrons for participating in today's ceremony. Please rise as able for the arrival of the colors and the singing of our national anthem and state song by Staff Sergeant Nick Daniels of the U.S. Pacific Fleet Band. Bugler, sound attention. Color Guard, parade the colors. Ladies and gentlemen, the national anthem of the United States of America. Please remain standing for the singing of Hawaii's state song, Hawaii Pono'i. Retire the colors. If you direct your attention across the harbor to the USS Arizona Memorial behind me, you will see that our national ensign has been raised and lowered to half staff. This is in tribute to all our service members lost on Oahu 76 years ago today. Guests, please be seated. It is customary for ships passing the USS Arizona Memorial to pay their respects by rendering honors. Last week, sailors aboard the aircraft carrier USS Nimitz namesake of Fleet Admiral Chester Nimitz, rendered honors to the USS Arizona, remembering all those who were lost 76 years ago today. Now we will render honors to the USS Arizona crew still entombed in their watery grave. Mr. Al Rodriguez, as a representative for all Pearl Harbor survivors, will lead us in a salute. He is escorted by Lieutenant Commander Michael Genta. Al Rodriguez was stationed on Section Base, Bishop's Point, Pearl Harbor, providing logistics for the small aircraft that docked there and preparing men to maintain the submarine nets that spanned the entrance to Pearl Harbor. On the morning of the attack, Al had been informed of the first American action of World War II. USS Ward had dropped depth charges on an unidentified submarine about a mile outside of the harbor entrance. Shortly after, just as Al sat down to breakfast, in fact, the general quarters alarm sounded. Everyone raced from the mess hall to the Army, where they could see the red rising sun symbol on the wings of the incoming planes. Once issued his .30 caliber rifle, Al and fellow sailors began to shoot at the planes as they flew overhead. He recalls the planes flying so low that he could see the faces of the pilots. 2 years later, Al was transferred to the battleship USS Washington. USS Washington had sunk Imperial Japan's battleship Kirishima at Guadalcanal and fought in the Gilbert and Marshall Islands, at Iwo Jima, and in the Battle of the Philippine Sea. In 1945, Al was transferred to the 3rd Naval District in New York City. When the war ended, Al returned home to Hawaii as a hero. He later retired after 24 years of honorable service. Al stands today for all Pearl Harbor survivors. At this time, would all Pearl Harbor survivors and other World War II veterans please stand as able? Mr. Rodriguez, facing the USS Arizona, will now lead us in a salute of those who lost their lives on December 7th, 1941. Carry on. Pearl Harbor survivors and World War II veterans, please be seated. In the Hawaiian culture, the religious leader or spiritual advisor is known as a kahu. Today, we are pleased to have for our invocation a Hawaiian blessing offered by Kanu Kanahele, Kahu O'Connor, Kahu Chang, and Kahu Makani.
This ancient sound recognizes the four powers of the earth in the north, the south, and the east and the west, giving full glory and life to Kahonua, the earth.
Be
This ancient chant recognizes the generations of the past, present, and the future. Let the world know that all shall stand to recognize our Creator. Epulikako, shall we pray? Keakua kamakua mauloa o kalani, our eternal Father in heaven. Aloha kakahi akia oe, good morning to you, Heavenly Father. And Heavenly Father, mahalo nui loa no ka ui o kia kakahi aka. Thank you so very, very much for the beautiful morning here in Hawaii nei. Heavenly Creator, mahalo nui for the survivors that have come here this day. Mahalo nui for the heroes that sacrificed their lives. And mahalo nui that in all of the sacrifice that have been provided for us, there is peace. How sacred each and every one of them are to our people and our nation and the world, for truly a symbol of great heroes. Heavenly Father, this is thy holiday season, and may I, as your kahu, humbly ask that you bless all of the branches of our military service, our great warriors, and especially their families. For far too often, sometimes we fall short of recognizing the importance of ohana, families. May we recognize in this prayer their husbands and their wives and their partners, and each and every single warrior that lifts up the arms and strength and even their aloha to take good care of every one of us, not only in our great nation, but throughout the world. Allow, please, in these difficult times, that there be a strength toward peace, that everything must be done to create peace. Heavenly Father, we, thy spiritual people of this ancient land of Hawaii nei, come before you to ask humbly in this sacred blessing that there shall be peace in the world. And with your aloha, in grateful thanksgiving to you, we humbly pray. No kamea no ke au puni a me kamana ka ho'onani ia a maloatu. In your sacred name, amen and amen.
For the past 36 years, the Japan Religious Committee for World Federation has offered a prayer for peace on this occasion, and we are honored to have them once again as part of this ceremony. Reverend Fujita will offer the prayer, followed by the English translation by Miss Miyahara.
私たち世界連邦日本宗教委員会は1982年5月29日より30日ニューヨークの聖ヨハネ大聖堂で開かれた日米宗教者会議に参加し、その日とここパールハーバーに立ち寄り慰霊の祈りを捧げさせていただきました。 そのことが最初のご縁となり、恒例の慰霊行事として年々回を重ね、今年で36回目を迎えることになりました。本年は真珠湾攻撃から76年、私たち日本人にとっては 終戦72年となりました。過去の出来事が時の流れとともに遠ざかっていくのはある意味仕方のないことかもしれません。しかし過去から導かれた英知を今の世代、次の世代へと伝えていくことは今を生きる私たちにとって何よりも重要な課題であり責務であると申せましょう。今ここに互いに集い共に祈りを捧げる私たちの姿は、一度は敵味方に分かれた者同士であっても親しい友、仲睦まじい同胞のように互いを思いやり信じ合うことができるようになるのだということを改めて私たちに確信させてくれます。昨年の12月、安倍晋三首相が日本国総理大臣としてアメリカ合衆国のバラク・オバマ大統領とともにここ真珠湾から寛容の大切さと和解の力を世界に訴えたことは今も人々の記憶に新しいところでありましょう。しかしながら未だ人類はテロや紛争、貧困、環境破壊といったさまざまな困難に直面し、私たちの理想とする世界の平和とは程遠い状況にあります。今こそ私たちはかつて日米両国が直面した大いなる悲劇と苦難によって心ならずも犠牲となられた方々に対し仁人なる哀悼の誠を捧げるとともに、先人から受け継いできた英知を結集し、共存共栄と相互敬愛の精神をもって一日も早い真の世界平和と全人類の幸福実現のために、宗教者信仰者として共に祈りと力を捧げることをここに誓います。
Our organization, the Japan Religious Committee for World Federation, are honored to be here to offer our prayer of peace and reconciliation for the past 36 years. This year marks 76 years since the attack on Pearl Harbor and 72 years since the end of World War II. Maybe it is natural to think that the past will be forgotten as time passes. However,It is our duty and responsibility to share the wisdom of the past and nurture that future generation. Last December, as you remember, Japan's Prime Minister Shinzo Abe and President Barack Obama came to Hawaii to pay their respect at Pearl Harbor. Together, they announced to the world the importance ofresilience and the strength of reconciliation. The world peace seems to be quite fragile these days due to threats such as terrorism, disagreement, poverty, and environmental destruction that continue to happen time and time again. Today, we are all gathered here to remember and pay our respects to those who sacrificed their lives when our countries face tragedy and hardship. We are here to share the wisdom that was passed down from previous generations, that all human beings must learn to live with one another in harmony and prosperity and in spirit of mutual love and respect. For that is the only path that will lead toward peace.We, as people of various religion and faith, vow to do everything in our power to bring about true world peace and happiness for all of humanity.
祈りましょう。
Let us pray.
世界が本当に平和になり、すべての人々が幸せでありますように。この地球を一つの家として生きとし生けるものが共に生き、慈しみと愛と誠に満ちた明るく楽しい世の中になりますように。
May true world peace prevail, and may all mankind know true happiness. And may we all learn to live together in this home that we share, and may our planet become a bright place that is full of compassion, love, and sincerity.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
ありがとうございました。
ありがとうございました。
Today's National Pearl Harbor Remembrance Day commemoration is co-hosted, as it has been since 2005, by the National Park Service and the United States Navy. Here to share an official welcome on behalf of the National Park Service is Jacqueline Ashwell, Superintendent of the World War II Valor in the Pacific National Monument.
Good morning. And aloha. We welcome you to today's 76th commemoration of National Pearl Harbor Remembrance Day. It is my incredible honor to welcome our World War II veterans and civilian witnesses of the attack on Pearl Harbor and Oahu. I am proud to call some of you friends. You honor us with your presence today. Among our dignitaries, and ladies and gentlemen, please hold your applause until I am done at the end, the Honorable David Ige, Governor of the State of Hawaii, Admiral Harry Harris, Commander, U.S. Pacific Command, General Terrence O'Shaughnessy, Commander, U.S. Pacific Air Forces, Admiral Scott Swift, Commander, U.S. Pacific Fleet, the Honorable Kirk Caldwell, Mayor of the City and County of Honolulu. The Honorable Bernard Carvalho, Mayor of the County of Kauai. The Honorable Isoda Tatsunobu, Mayor of Nagaoka City. Members of the Counselor Corps, members of the Senior Executive Service, and all flag and general officers, elected and appointed officials, business and community leaders, welcome. This year's theme, Rising to the Challenge, evokes the motivation of what America and its institutions faced in the desperate year of 1942. Americans were confronted with the reality of a global war. World War II had come to America. We were busy in the Pacific and in Europe and on the home front. American citizens rose to support the war effort in a variety of ways. Often overlooked in the history of World War II in America is how the National Park Service rose to the challenge that confronted our nation. During World War II, the national parks likewise went to war. Many park roads and facilities were cleared of their visitors to make way for military equipment and personnel. The vast amounts of government-owned land, harsh terrain, and remoteness of many national parks made them ideal for military training. Mount Rainier National Park served as a winter training and testing ground for the U.S. Army's 10th Mountain Division and other military units. This cold weather equipment testing and training prepared its soldiers for their march through the Apennine Mountains to capture German strongholds. Yosemite National Park joined the war effort with the rest of the nation. In addition to its military hospital, Yosemite National Park hosted the United States Army Signal Corps for a training camp and for visiting Army units. Victory gardens were planted in the employee housing areas. On many occasions during the war, personnel from both the military and the National Park Service assisted one another, reminiscent of today. Olympic National Park personnel instructed groups of military men in firefighting techniques and organized recreational trips into the park. While men of the 15th Cavalry were stationed at Port Angeles, Washington, the park opened up the swimming pool at Olympic Hot Springs for their use. On several occasions, the U.S. Coast Guard took National Park Service personnel on aerial surveys for study purposes of their parks. Both the Navy and the Coast Guard supplied the park with men to fight forest fires. During World War II, more than 7,000 air crashes involving U.S. Army Air Force aircraft occurred on American soil. Collectively, these crashes resulted in the loss of over 15,000 lives. Many of these military aircraft accidents occurred in remote, often mountainous areas of national parks. Rangers assisted in rescue and salvage operations. Throughout the war, National Park Service Director Newton B. Drury was in a war of his own. Drury was responsible for protecting the precious resources of America's national parks unimpaired for future generations. He successfully resisted the overwhelming demands for the use of park resources to aid in the war effort. While providing some training areas, Drury saved many of America's pristine parks from irreversible logging, bombing, mining, and more. There are darker sides to this history as well. Kilauea Military Camp was established in 1916, surrounded by Hawaii Volcanoes National Park, which was established that same year. Kilauea Military Camp still operates today, a century later, as a morale, welfare, and recreation facility. The camp and the national park just celebrated their centennial. In the days and weeks after the December 7th attack here on Oahu, fueled by racial prejudice, wartime hysteria, and a failure of political leadership, the 50-acre Kilauea camp was converted into the largest Hawaiian incarceration site outside of this island. It housed prisoners, many of whom were local residents of Japanese ancestry. Here at Pearl Harbor, there was no National Park Service in 1942. Not yet. 1 year after the attack, sailors and civilian workers gathered on the afterdeck of the sunken hulk of the battleship USS Arizona. It was the first December 7th service of remembrance. Words were spoken, prayers were given, taps was sounded as they remembered those who were killed there and all across Oahu. Even then, with the war still raging, they knew that it was important to remember and commemorate this event. We still do. Since 1980, the National Park Service and the United States Navy have hosted millions of visitors from all walks of life who have come to pay their respects and to remember. The National Park Service mission, in partnership with the United States Navy, Pacific Historic Parks, the USS Bowfin Submarine, the Pacific Aviation Museum, and the USS Missouri, is to preserve, interpret, and commemorate the history of World War II in the Pacific from the events leading up to the December 7, 1941 attack on Oahu, to the tragic events of that day and their repercussions, up to and including peace and reconciliation. Thank you for gathering with us here today. By doing so, you assist us in that mission, to be part of that legacy of remembrance, a tradition established here in 1942.
Thank you, Superintendent Ashwell. Ladies and gentlemen, it's now my pleasure to introduce our Navy co-host and distinguished speaker. Admiral Swift oversees the Pacific Ocean Theater Level Component Command of the United States Navy that provides naval forces to the United States Pacific Command, including all home-ported surface ships here in Hawaii. Please welcome the commander, United States Pacific Fleet, Admiral Scott Swift.
Well, good morning, Admiral Harris, Governor Ige, thank you for joining us here this morning. Could not have asked for a more beautiful morning, and for those of us that have spoken on December 7th and sat here on the dais, invariably someone will approach us and say, you know, it's unfortunate that you don't have the nicest view looking out across the harbor. But I would argue otherwise, standing here looking across this front row of Pearl Harbor survivors. It's great to see so many old friends back here today. So it's truly an honor to join you in remembrance of those heroes, these heroes, that were unexpectedly thrust into the crucible of war here more than seven decades ago. Heroes whose honor, courage, and commitment amidst adversity continue to inspire generations of American service members and citizens today. This morning, as we have for the last 76 years, we gather here to pay our respect to America's World War II generation, the greatest generation, and in particular, our veterans and civilians that responded to the attack on Pearl Harbor. Grateful for their courage, service, and sacrifice. We also honor fallen shipmates and all others who fell that day as we mourn the loss of so many of our nation's best and brightest. Within the chaos that morning, there was no shortage of bravery as sailors, soldiers, airmen, Marines, and Coast Guardsmen overcame shock, uncertainty, and fear in the heat of battle to find something greater within themselves, a grim determination to survive and an unwavering resolve to fight. Unsurprisingly, in my experience, is that none of these heroes considers themselves as such. They all say they were just doing their job. I guess that is true if just doing your job entails 15 Medal of Honors, 51 Navy Crosses being awarded, many posthumously, all of which highlights the valor displayed that morning 76 years ago today. Make no mistake, though all awoke that morning as ordinary sailors, soldiers, airmen, Marines, and Coast Guardsmen, by the time the guns fell silent, they were heroes all. Among those we honor today are the captain and crew of the USS Ward, just discovered the other day, whose vigilance and decisive action at the very cusp of the transition between peacetime and world war demonstrated a readiness, determination, and tenacity that informs our fleet today. I'd like to pause here a moment to reflect on history and cultural heritage and why each is important to what we do and who we are as a fleet today. History is what happens on a day-to-day basis. Those events that are recorded for posterity, which we in turn use to inform future decisions. Our cultural heritage, on the other hand, is the effect of the span of history on us as a group, embodied largely in how we respond to the events of the day. This brings me back to the USS Ward, the ship that fired America's first salvo in World War II. Ward was a World War I era destroyer that had been decommissioned for nearly 20 years and brought back into service in January of 1941. The United States had been at peace for longer than Ward had been out of service, though the winds of war had already begun blowing just over the horizon by December. The crew was made up primarily of enlisted reservists from the Midwest who previously honed their seamanship skills on the Great Lakes and the Mississippi River. Both ship and crew had been activated as part of America's leadership's effort to prepare for potential hostilities, but peacetime training can never be as trying as operating in war. Ward's performance that morning is exceptional, the details of which I'll leave to Mr. Toomey to regale you with the details of that engagement. Though I'll take a moment here to highlight how her story still speaks volumes to our fleet today. One might almost have excused Ward's team from any reluctance they may have had to mount an armed attack during peace without contacting higher headquarters with incomplete information. What I find compelling about Ward's story is that the crew overcame the culture of a peacetime fleet posture so quickly and effectively. They were able to do so because they had the clear understanding of their commander's intent, of their assigned duties, and of the risks of inaction. Ward's experience reminds us today that the transition from operating as a peacetime Navy to conducting wartime missions can happen in an instant, and we as a fleet need to be prepared to act. Her example, and the example of all the Pearl Harbor survivors, underscores the value of equipping and empowering our sailors and civilian sailors with proper training, sufficient resources, and most of all, clear commander's intent to act decisively when conditions require. To ensure they were ready to fight at a moment's notice. As leaders, we owe it to our sailors to remember that readiness can't be measured in how we as a Navy perform in peacetime. Rather, it must be evaluated within the context of how well we can fight and win when our mettle is tested in combat, as it was 75 years ago this morning here in Pearl Harbor. That said, while preparing ourselves for the demands of that potential adversary, whatever they may place on us, we still must balance the maintenance, manning, training requirements of a peacetime fleet. That is no simple task, but I can tell you that Pacific Fleet sailors, that it's the American citizens' view that they have entrusted us with that responsibility. America's experience at Pearl Harbor reminds us we cannot be trapped by our most recent historical events, that the heroes with us today ensured Pearl Harbor would not be the end of the story. If that had occurred, it would have been a gloomy day indeed. But that sweeping defeat here that morning, 76 years ago, was short-lived. Instead of retreating from the fight, America's Pacific Fleet dug in its heels. Along the way, they forged a cultural heritage of resilience that sailors continue to draw upon today. Indeed, America's sailors, civilian sailors, and members of all military branches made sure that the adversary intended as the first and last battle of a short war was only the opening act. Within days, Pacific Fleet submarines launched an offensive patrols, taking the fight to the enemy. Likewise, fleet crypto analysts in the basement of Station Hypo refused to give up, despite earlier setbacks that failed to foresee the attack. Instead, they redoubled their efforts to break the Imperial Navy's code to anticipate the adversary's next move. All along the waterfront, dive and salvage crews, shipyard workers, and ship's company labored around the clock to save lives and resurrect the vessels that they could. Across the island and across our nation, Americans were rising to the challenge. Within 6 months, the critical victories at the Battle of Coral Sea and Midway the Pacific Fleet sailors and civilian sailors had delivered a blow to the adversary that shifted the momentum of the war, thanks in no small part to Station Hypo's dogged tenacity. By the end of the war, Pacific Fleet submarines had conducted 488 war patrols and were responsible for more than half of all enemy shipping sunk. And remarkably, shipyard and salvage professionals were able to return 17 ships that were either damaged or sunk in Pearl Harbor back to service, many of which fought valiantly throughout the remainder of the war. On behalf of a grateful Pacific nation and a proud Pacific Fleet, I would like to thank our Pearl Harbor and World War II veterans who yet carry the burden and bear the scars of those fateful days. We honor you today for the proud cultural heritage of victory and toughness that you have bestowed on each of us that now wear the uniform in your honor. We remain forever in your debt. During this time of reflection, I am also grateful to observe the strong bonds that have formed between former bitter adversaries. I cannot help but note that just as the crew of the USS Ward was not caught unprepared by peacetime mentality, likewise, the Pacific Fleet was not trapped by fear and uncertainty following the attack that morning. And at the war's end, American and Japanese leadership did not remain bound by our former wartime hostilities, but instead chose to forge a new future of reconciliation that has benefited both of our nations and indeed the entire Indo-Asia-Pacific region in incalculable ways. December 7th holds a number of hard lessons that no sailor of any nation should have to relearn. Though the wounds dealt here more than seven decades ago are fading, we will never forget the valor, heroism, and leadership displayed by all those who gave their lives here 76 years ago. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Admiral Swift. I now welcome this year's keynote speaker, Pulitzer Prize-winning writer and journalist Steve Toomey. Mr. Toomey worked for the Philadelphia Inquirer and the Washington Post. He has written for Smithsonian and other magazines and taught narrative writing at the graduate schools of New York University and City University of New York. He's the author of Countdown to Pearl Harbor. Ladies and gentlemen, Steve Toomey.
Thank you for the privilege of being here with you this morning. I'd like to begin a long way away in England. Over there, it was late evening when Winston Churchill happened to turn on the radio at his country estate and hear the first bulletins about the attack here at Pearl. A short time later, the Prime Minister retired for the evening. And he was flooded with emotions that you and I might think were wildly insensitive, given what he was just hearing. He was, in a word, overjoyed. "I went to bed," he wrote, "and slept the sleep of the saved and thankful." These were hardly the emotions of Americans. These were hardly the emotions of a young Navy spouse named Grace Outerbridge. Let me tell you about Grace's December 7th. As Churchill was slumbering into the wee hours, Grace put her three boys to bed in San Diego and began to write a letter to her husband, who was a destroyer captain here at Pearl. Today we live in an age of instant messages and email, but Grace's world still relied on letters and telegrams and scratchy long-distance phone calls, and she had gotten neither a telegram nor a phone call about whether Lieutenant Outerbridge had survived the raid she had been hearing about on the radio all day. Grace verged on the frantic. Her doctor prescribed sleeping pills, and he even dropped off a bottle of scotch, and she used both. I am practically drunk, she wrote to Billy, not knowing whether he would ever read the words. She did not learn his fate the next day, nor the next day, nor the next day. She wrote him again, don't know how much longer I can stand this. In its 165 years of existence, the country had never experienced a moment so low and so uncertain and so scary. Instantly, from coast to coast, families shuddered at the realization that their sons, husbands, brothers, fathers, uncles were going to be sucked into harm's way. And then, to make matters worse, Germany and Italy declared war. Yet somehow on the night of December 7th, as Grace Outerbridge and the whole country wrestled with fear and confusion, there was Winston Churchill sleeping his happy sleep. Not because he was naive or callous, but because for the first time in 2 years of war, he felt England would live. Pearl Harbor had given him a partner, a full, reliable, game-changing partner. And he felt that way even knowing there were some people in the world who held a much darker view of whether Americans were up to the challenge of a brutal global war. Churchill wrote this, some said the Americans were soft. Others said they would never be united. They would fool around at a distance. They would never come to grips. They would never stand bloodletting. This, he thought, was so much nonsense. First of all, Winston Churchill was the son of an American mother, the former Miss Jenny Jerome of Brooklyn, New York. So he was more than casually acquainted with our species. More to the point, Churchill had studied the American Civil War, and he was well aware of how much blood had been let at Antietam and Gettysburg and Chancellorsville and so many other places. He knew that Americans had been knocked down by Pearl Harbor, but he also knew they would get back up. They would be in the fight, as he put it, up to the neck and in to the death. You and I have come to call these Americans our greatest generation. But I doubt that in those first early months, or ever, they went around wearing t-shirts that proclaimed, "We're awesome." They simply got on with it. With the fighting and the rationing and the manufacturing and the bond buying and, yes, the dying. Today, I'd like to briefly share some stories about how they answered the call of December 7th. 5 days after the attack, a young man walked onto the grounds of Fort Sheridan, just north of Chicago. His name was Gray Agerholm. He was 24 years old. By birth, he was an American, a dairy farmer's son from a town called Luck in Wisconsin. By blood, however, Gray was 100% Danish. His parents, Martin and Marie, had yet to start a family when they sailed into New York Harbor on March 25th, 1908, having decided that America offered a better future than Denmark and would be a better place to start their family. Gray would be the fifth of eight children. That day at Fort Sheridan, December 12th, Gray enlisted in the Army, obviously moved by Pearl Harbor and by what had been done to America, the adopted home of his parents. The Army put him in the 32nd Division, composed mostly of boys from Wisconsin and Michigan, many of them the sons of immigrants, just as Gray was. And it wasn't long before they found themselves bound for an island that I doubt many of them, perhaps none of them, could find on a map. Papua New Guinea. Soon, the boys were advancing into the hot, thick, rainy jungle and coming to grips with the enemy face to face. Remember how skeptics thought Americans weren't able to do that. A correspondent for Life magazine was with the 32nd. He wrote that New Guinea looked like a lush painting of the tropics, except that the falling shells made the ground shake like a continuous earthquake, and the air smelled like a charnel house, and the palm trees hid enemy snipers. Gray Agerholm and the boys kept slogging ahead. They are now grim, hardened jungle fighters, Life magazine said. They need to be. It's kill or be killed. 76 years ago this morning, a man known as the Colonel was having lunch in Chicago. Nobody hated Franklin Roosevelt more than Robert McCormick. He was the cantankerous owner of the Chicago Tribune, the most rabidly anti-Roosevelt newspaper in the country. When word of the attack reached him, the Colonel apologized to his luncheon companions, got up, and raced back to the office to write an editorial. It appeared on the Tribune's front page the next morning. It announced that the time for squabbling among ourselves was over. All of us, the Colonel thundered, from this day forward, have only one task. That is to strike with all our might. Another prominent isolationist agreed, only he put it a little bit more bluntly. Let's lick the hell out of them. So much for doubts about American unity. As the Colonel was writing that editorial, a young Navy officer named Joseph Rochefort was at his post here at Pearl, too dumbfounded by the attack to say much to his men. Joe commanded a group of Navy cryptologists and linguists. Their job, even in peacetime, was to intercept and analyze Japanese radio traffic, crack their codes, and tell the higher-ups what the Imperial Navy was up to. But Joe's team had not detected the Japanese coming on December 7th, at least not coming to Pearl Harbor. He would later say that the disaster was his fault, all his fault. Now, actually, there had been mistakes and misjudgments aplenty. But you and I might have understood if Joe had sunk into a paralyzed funk and disappeared from the pages of history. Imagine if you felt personally responsible for the worst day in the annals of the Navy. Instead, Joe got on with it. In the coming months, he and his men got better and better at reading the enemy's codes and better at anticipating his moves. They worked endlessly in the stifling, smoke-filled, windowless basement of a building that still stands over there. Joe even slept there. So much for American softness. On June 4, 1942, of course, the Pacific Fleet ambushed an immense Japanese task force off the island of Midway, and the core of the enemy's carrier forces went to the bottom that day, and the war turned a corner. That trap could be sprung because Joe and his men had solved Japan's most complex code and knew where her ships were going to be. I was merely doing what I was paid to do, Joe said, which wasn't true. He didn't do it for the money. The last person I'd like to tell you about is a rather obscure, average, but delightful civilian from Missouri. Mary Lou Sigler was young and single and ready to work, as so many were. She wound up at a Pratt & Whitney plant in Kansas City where they made aircraft engines. Now, this Rosie didn't do any riveting. This Rosie was in accounting. But they were pretty busy in accounting. Every day, 15 more engines rolled out of that plant, 7 days a week, 400 a month. That single factory had made 7,900 engines by the end of the war. And those engines powered great swarms of Hellcats, Marauders, and Thunderbolts. Mary Lou Sigler from accounting would become my mother after the war. I bet a lot of you have a Rosie or two in the family tree, a mother, a grandmother, an aunt, a great aunt, who put up with the sacrifices and turned out the weapons. Just how determined and resourceful were American civilians? Well, I have the perfect example. 76 years ago today, the battleship West Virginia lay near death along Battleship Row, right behind me. Punctured by multiple torpedoes, bombed repeatedly, she had settled to the shallow bottom of the harbor. She was literally down, but she was not out. Shipyard surgeons went to work, first here at Pearl and then at Puget Sound, stitching her wounds, repairing her guts. The workers didn't just make her whole, they made her better than ever. And then they sent the West Virginia back to sea to fight. On September 2nd, 1945, an armada of American warships stood at anchor in Tokyo Bay as Japan surrendered. One of those ships was the West Virginia. What perfect symmetry that is. She had been a battered victim at the awful beginning and was now a majestic witness at the glorious end, the end that Winston Churchill had known would come. The surrender meant the beginning of the occupation, of course, and among the American forces that landed in Japan was that division I told you about, the one from Michigan and Wisconsin. It's been said that the 32nd spent more days in combat than any other unit in either theater. And I wish I could tell you that Gray Egerholm, the son of Danish immigrants, had survived it all, but he had not. As the 32nd had made its final victorious push in Papua New Guinea, way back in 1942, a bullet had found Gray, and he had died of his wound on New Year's Eve near a town called Buna. 2 weeks later, a telegram arrived in a Wisconsin town called Luck. It was addressed to Gray's mother. The Secretary of Defense desires me to express his deep regret that your son, Private Gray R. Egerholm, was killed in action in defense of his country. Think about that. His parents had chosen to leave Denmark in quest of a new life in a new country. Their son had risen to the defense of that new country in its hour of peril. And now he had given his life so that it might remain the great good place of his parents' dreams. I don't want to end on that somber note. So let's finish the story of Grace and Billy Outerbridge. On December 12th, a telegram arrived, finally reaching Grace. She hesitated to open it, but then she did, and read the five most beautiful words of her married life. Well and happy, William Outerbridge. Her husband hadn't been in touch sooner because he was fighting the new war. Actually, Billy had fired the first shots. In the early light of December 7, he and his destroyer were on a routine patrol offshore not far from where we sit. It was 6:37 a.m., and the country had been enjoying peace for decades. Suddenly, there was a conning tower poking just above the surface, almost directly ahead. It clearly was not American. The captain was summoned to the bridge. Now, Billy Outerbridge had never commanded a ship until this one. He had assumed command of the ward 2 days before. He had taken her to sea for the first time only yesterday. Now on Sunday, rousted from a deep sleep in his bunk and wearing a kimono, the brand new captain faced a momentous decision. What should he do about this submarine? Could this really be the Japanese? Was the long, long peace finally over? Billy hesitated not a single second. One look he gave, the helmsman would say later, and called general quarters. The ward shot forward. Billy told his boys to open fire. The Japanese lost a submarine. In a few days, Billy wrote to Grace to tell her what had happened. Joined the ship Friday, got underway Saturday morning, and started the war on Sunday. In other words, William Outerbridge had risen to the challenge. As Gray Agerholm would, as Robert McCormick would, as Joe Rochefort would, and my mother, and perhaps your dad, and your grandfather, and all your other relatives, and millions more. Let's hope you and I never confront national danger of such magnitude. But let's hope that if we do, we rise to meet it as well as they did. Thank you. It has been an honor to be with you.
Thank you, Mr. Toomey. Thank you very much. This morning, we will place wreaths to honor the territory of Hawaii, Army, Marine Corps, Navy, Air Force, and Coast Guard. The wreaths will be presented by active duty service members and National Park Service Rangers. The wreaths you're about to see presented are an expression of our gratitude and a symbol of our unending appreciation of service and sacrifice. Today, we honor heroes, military and civilian, who lost their lives on December 7th, 1941. This presentation represents our past and present. It honors those who fight in the name of freedom 76 years ago and recognizes our veterans who continue to serve our country today with honor, courage, and commitment. These wreaths also represent hope that future generations will never forget the sacrifices that have made freedom possible. As each wreath is presented, you will hear a toll from the USS Arizona ship's bell. This bell is one of two salvaged from the sunken ship. Commissioned in 1916, the USS Arizona was the second and last of the super dreadnought battleships. USS Arizona's journey began in World War I, but sadly would end in the attack on Pearl Harbor on December 7th, 1941. Now marking the final resting place of more than 1,000 sailors and Marines from her crew, the USS Arizona is also a steady reminder of all American service members killed on December 7th, 1941, and throughout the entirety of World War II. The territory of Hawaii. On that fateful morning, 49 civilians lost their lives in Hawaii as a result of the attack. As a base for all of the military services, the then territory of Hawaii and its citizens played a major role in one of history's greatest salvage and repair efforts, quickly restoring most of the damaged ships and expediting their return to the fleet. Hawaii citizens opened their homes and businesses to servicemen stationed in the islands and those returning from war patrols. Today, the state of Hawaii remains a strategic and welcoming home port for our military, continuing to offer aloha to all. Representing the territory of Hawaii is Micah Velasco, and Park Ranger Joseph Borgia of Guam. Will all our civilian survivors and witnesses please stand as possible? Thank you. United States Army. While many history books tend to focus on the December 7th attack on Pearl Harbor, in fact, the entire island of Oahu was under fire, and brave members of the United States Army fought diligently to defend their post that fateful day. From Schofield Barracks to Bellows Airfield, the U.S. Army had and continues to have an important presence here on Oahu. Representing the United States Army is Sergeant Zachary Watlett of Pennsylvania and Park Ranger Rebecca Schwab of New Hampshire. Will all of our Army veterans please stand as able? United States Army veterans, thank you, and please be seated. United States Marine Corps. Many may not realize that in 1941, a United States Marines detachment made up an important part of each battleship's crew. Upon visiting the USS Arizona Memorial, however, you will notice many names inscribed on the wall of the Shrine Room that make up a large portion of the 109 Marines who lost their lives on December 7th. In total, 105 Marines perished aboard ships in Pearl Harbor, and four were killed in action at Eva Mooring Mass Field. Representing the United States Marine Corps, Sergeant Manuel Garcia of California and Park Ranger Pamela Flores of Nebraska, will all of our Marine Corps veterans please stand as able? Thank you, Marine Corps veterans. Please be seated. United States Navy. 1,999 sailors lost their lives in the December 7th attack on Pearl Harbor and Naval Air Station Kanahoe Bay. Many sailors met their final resting place in the waters directly behind me while defending their ships and helping their shipmates escape the burning waters. Many more assisted in rescue and recovery efforts in the days and weeks that followed. Representing the United States Navy is Ship Serviceman First Class LaVita Boone and Park Ranger William Crow, both of California. Will all of our Navy veterans please stand as able? Thank you, Navy veterans. Please be seated. The United States Air Force. Though not yet a service in 1941, the United States Air Force was formerly referred to as our Army Air Corps, and here on Oahu as the Hawaiian Air Force. On December 7th, Lieutenants Ken Taylor and George Welch scrambled to their aircraft parked at Haleiwa Field and took off to brave the skies against incredible odds. Representing the United States Air Force is Airman First Class Kyla Mirani of California and Park Ranger Gina Stutchberry of Texas. Will all of our Air Force veterans please stand as able? Thank you, Air Force veterans. Please be seated. The United States Coast Guard. At the time of the attack, U.S. Coast Guard vessels in Hawaii were all stationed in Honolulu. At 6:45, the patrol craft Tiger intercepted a dispatch from the USS Ward that claimed destruction of a submarine. Later, Tiger itself came under enemy fire as it too participated in the defense of Oahu. Representing the United States Coast Guard is Master Chief Petty Officer Michael Collins of Florida and Park Ranger Daniel Brown of Washington. Will all of our Coast Guard veterans please stand as able? Thank you, Coast Guard veterans, and please be seated. Wreath presenters, thank you one and all. At this time, would all Pearl Harbor survivors and other World War II veterans please remain seated so the rest of all of us can honor you. On December 7th, 1941, and in the years that followed, you superbly executed your duties at your post, and you weathered the storm of war. It is because of you and others like you that we enjoy freedom and liberty in this great country. With all of our Pearl Harbor survivors and World War II veterans remaining seated, I invite everyone else as able to please stand and join me as we express our appreciation and graciousness towards these gentlemen, men and women. Thank you, World War II and Pearl Harbor survivors. A grateful nation applauded you today. Please be seated. A vintage 1940s Globe Swift aircraft will soon fly overhead. With its sleek lines and retractable landing gear, this aircraft was the economical civilian counterpart to the fighter aircraft that pilots flew during World War II. This was the fighter surrogate thousands of World War II pilots came home to fly, as it shares many common features with the U.S. Army Air Corps P-40 fighter. Only 1,521 of these Globe Swift aircraft were manufactured, with production ceasing in 1951. We thank Commander Bruce Mays, United States Coast Guard retired, and the Pacific Warbirds for providing today's vintage aircraft tribute. At this time, please rise as able and remain standing for the benediction, Marine Corps rifle salute, and echo taps played by the Pacific Fleet Band. Captain Brian Haley, Chaplain, Navy Region Hawaii, and Naval Service Naval Surface Group Middle Pacific will now offer the benediction.
Good morning and aloha. Please join me in prayer. Almighty Heavenly Father, as we reflect on the events of 76 years ago, our hearts are filled with awe and admiration at the testimony of the eyewitnesses we honor today. We would have imagined, who would have imagined, that such an unbreakable bond of friendship could be forged between such fierce enemies of yesterday. And yet here we stand today, together remembering the sacrifices of those who purchased our freedom with their own blood. Their lives and remembrance frame current events into a picture that brings focus to the urgency of our readiness and vigilance. Grant us now, as we leave this place, a firm commitment to pass the baton of remembrance to those whose future peace and freedom depend upon their commitment to never forget. Help us to remember the many lives cut short in yesterday's battle for justice and peace, so that we might be encouraged by their example to fight today's battles for freedom. Rekindle in our hearts the torch of freedom with a blazing commitment to bear it from this generation to the next. As we face new challenges and threats, bless all who stand in harm's way and defend our great nation. Keep your almighty hand upon them and grant protection and strength. Above all else, O God, bless America and our allies for peace this December 7th morning. May we keep our trust in you and remain one nation under you. In your holy name we pray, amen.
Stand by for rifle salute. Hand salute. Ready, two. Side boys, post. Thank you. Turn back around. Please remain standing for the departure of the official party and our honored guests. Pacific Fleet departing. Superintendent Jacqueline Ashwell departing. Mr. Steve Toomey departing. We now ask the general audience to please remain in your seats for a few moments as our most honored guests, Pearl Harbor survivors and other World War II veterans, depart. Would all Pearl Harbor survivors, both military and civilian, as well as other World War II veterans and their families and caregivers, please make your way to the front and near the stage and toward the honor cordon at this time, right here in front of the stage, please. At this time, service members from all branches will now salute the December 7th survivors and World War II veterans as they participate in the Walk of Honor tribute toward the theater. On behalf of the National Park Service and the United States Navy, thank you for attending today's special observance of the 76th anniversary of the attack on Oahu, rising to the challenge, and for remembering the sacrifices made by those who served on December 7th, 1941. Thank you as well to the many volunteers who made this ceremony possible today. And to those who are watching our ceremony through online broadcast, we'd like to extend a sincere aloha. Tugboats from Joint Base Pearl Harbor Hickam will be in the harbor conducting a water tribute. Please enjoy patriotic songs performed by the United States Pacific Fleet Band, and we hope you enjoy the rest of your day. Thank you for participating in this year's 76th commemoration as we rise to the challenge and remember Pearl Harbor. Thank you. Thank you.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean